Amen. Well, we should let that be our anthem, right? You are holy. You are holy. After all, he is holy. Amen. I mean, it's his holiness. We can't even grasp in this fleshly condition that we are in as mere mortals. We cannot be in the full presence of his holiness. So we can't take it. We can't take it. We have to have glorified bodies to be in his full presence, the full presence of his glory. Amen. Amen. Because his holiness is just so great. It's so awesome. It's more than we can comprehend. That's why the song says, I can't even comprehend it. I mean, he is holy. There are not English words. There's not a language that can adequately describe the holiness of God, because that's just who he is. God is holy. You cannot separate God's holiness from God, because God is holy. Amen. And it ought to just do something inside of us. Those of us who know Christ, when we think of the holiness of God, it ought to awaken an anthem inside of us. So we join with the angels in singing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory, right? I mean, it should do that in us. One day we're going to be gathered around the throne with the elders in heaven. We're going to be gathered around there, and it's going to be a constant chorus going on of God's holiness, constant singing, 24/7, falling down and giving praise to God, because that's how worthy he is. And we're going to be singing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Because that's who he is. Man, I love the holiness of God. I love the holiness of God. Well, it's been quite a transition for us. And we thank all of you who helped us move in on Friday. We thank those of you who stopped in just to say hi, just to check on us. And all of you who've been praying for us and praying for this transition. We've been praying, and God's given us a peace about being here. And I was trying to explain it to somebody else. I don't know how to really explain the peace, but I guess that's the peace of God, right? The peace that passes understanding. So the peace of God is the peace of God, and we let it be the peace of God. Amen. We don't understand it. We don't have to reason it out, but the peace of God is the peace of God. And so that's why we're here. God has called us, and we've answered the call, and we just look forward to getting to meet all of y'all, and we just look forward to what God has. I mean, I believe that God has more, as the Word teaches us. God has more in store for us than what we can possibly even ask or think or imagine. That's our God. He's a God of unlimited potential, all right? And he wants us to realize that. He wants us to grasp that he has more for us. Amen? It's not based on me. It's not based on a former pastor. It's not based on anybody else but God and his favor upon us and what God wants to do. It's all about God and his glory. Amen. Amen. It's all about him. And one of the things you're going to find out about me is I'm very passionate about being a father. I love my children. I love my children. I love my family. And so in honor of this being Father's, or next week being Father's Day, we're going to start today a three-week series on the spiritual role of fathers. And it's not just for fathers, but it's for wives. It's for the other women in the congregation as well, to hold men accountable to their spiritual role as fathers. Amen? And so the title we're going to give of this sermon series for the next 3 weeks is going to be this: Never Let Go of the Wheel. Never Let Go of the Wheel. And the first thing we're going to be talking about in this series is that as a father, the big thought, everybody say, here's a big thought. Just say, here's a big thought. Look at the person next to you and say, here's a big thought. I'm not going to get really complicated on you. I'm not going to do anything like that. But here's the one big thought I want you to grasp this morning, okay? That God has called fathers to be spiritual priests, the family priests in their family. God has called fathers to be the priests in their family, okay? I take it very seriously, God's role for me. As I read in the scriptures in Ephesians, the Bible ordains me as the head of my household. not as a head as to abuse that authority or to have authority that I just say it's all about me and it's all about my way or the highways. It's nothing like that. But my authority and my leadership as being the head of my household, as it's outlined in the book of Ephesians, is to lead sacrificially. It's to lead in the things of God. That's my role. That's my role. And I used to sort of take this role kind of lightly. We have family devotions in our house every night, just about, as long as we're all able to do it and as long as we're all together. We'll have family devotions in our house. And what that means is we'll get together, we read the Bible, we pray, we have a prayer we pray every night. In the mornings, usually we go over a scripture memory verse and we read about what Jesus is doing today. We'll read out of the Gospels. I love doing that with my family. But you know, I took that leadership role kind of loosely at first until I really needed God. And until I realized that my family really needed God in the spiritual direction of the Word. I was down in El Salvador, and I can remember, I'd just gotten over dengue fever. And what dengue fever is, it's a form of West Nile virus that once a mosquito that carries this virus stings you. Then you get sick. I was sick for about 11 days with high fever. They call it the bone-crushing disease. So I was sick, and I was so sick, I just didn't want to be there. And I was complaining to God. I was complaining to my wife. I was complaining to my kids. I mean, I was there, and I just needed somebody to have pity on me, right? I mean, here is this little baby of a man needing somebody to have pity on him. And you know what my wife said? She said, "I need you to be strong." Man, that got deep. I wanted her to say, "Oh, I'm sorry, let's go home, you're right." But no, she said, "I need you to be strong." And so from that moment on, I started really taking seriously my role as a father in the house. That yes, we both heard from God in the direction that he was placing us in our life, or the direction he was sending us. But as a father, I needed to step up and lead my family, and I needed to be strong. When they weren't strong, I needed to be strong. And how do I get strong? But only by receiving strength from God. And only by leading, by spiritual example. I have to be close with God if I want my family to be close with God. I have to be reading and praying. If I expect my family to be doing this, I have to be doing it myself. And so then I started gaining strength from God. And in going through these spiritual disciplines with my family. And then I started searching scriptures about just a little bit more of what the spiritual role of fathers are. And we find in Deuteronomy 6, 5 through 7, as they're going to have it on the screen, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words which I'm commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise." I should be teaching my family all throughout the day. These commands of God, they're just that valuable that in everything that I do throughout the day that I need to be teaching. I need to be reminding my kids of God's stories and of God's commands. Whenever my son falters and he disobeys me, I need to remind him, "Josiah, God says that you have to obey your mom and dad. You have to honor them." Whenever they do something good, I have to remind them of how they are acting in grace, how they are acting in mercy. I have to be reciting these scriptures and helping them memorize the scriptures, because the word, as it reminds us also in Deuteronomy, it is to us life. It's not a dead book. This book is not dead. It is an ancient book, but it's just as alive today as whenever God spoke it through the mouth of his prophets. Amen. Amen. This book is life to us, and it's life to our family. I was talking to a sister down there in Florida right before we left. She was telling me of this awesome miracle that God had done in the life of her family. Her children were in a horrible car accident. And her son had to be lifelighted from this wreck. And I mean, it just looked horrible. But the whole time, as she was driving from the accident scene to the hospital, she was praying in the name of Jesus. She was praying that God would raise him up. And she was praying and she was praying and she was praying. She was praying at the scene. She was praying on the way. She was praying when she got there. And you know what? God blessed them with a wonderful recovery. But you know what she said? Jeremy, we remind our kids of this God story. Every chance we get, we remind them of what God has done for us. What God had done for them in answering our prayers. And I think that's what we need to do with our children. We need to remind them of God's stories, right? How else are they going to learn? Is it the Sunday school superintendent or the Sunday school teacher's responsibility? No. Is it the youth pastor? No. Is it the pastor? No. It is our responsibility as parents to teach our children. Deuteronomy says so. It's our responsibility. It's our responsibility. Then I looked at Ephesians 6:4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Man, that's pretty straightforward, right? We bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. That word bring them up is actually a nurturing. You nurture your family in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. With the whole counsel of God we find in here, we discipline, we instruct. That's what the Bible says. And in 1 Peter 2:9, we find this verse, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, so you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And so we see here that there's a picture of those who are redeemed by God, those who claim Jesus as their Savior, becoming a royal priesthood. A priesthood. Now, what was a priest in the ancient times, in ancient Jewish culture? What was a priest? A priest was a mediator, someone who stood between God and man and made sacrifices on behalf of the people. The people would bring their sacrifices, and the priest would offer acceptable sacrifices unto God. Going a step further back into the history of Jewish culture as a family, it's recorded that the father of the family would actually be known as the family priest. How? It was the father's responsibility. They took it very serious to teach their kids the Torah, first five books of the Bible. They took that very seriously. It was the fathers who led in the celebrating of the feasts and the different celebrations. It was the father. As the family priest, it was his responsibility that they would do that. And so how do we translate that today? Well, we've got to take the Word of God for what it is. Amen? And for what the Word of God says. And we have to take the culture around which this Word was written in and apply that to our life. And so does that mean we are supposed to be the priests of our family? I believe so. I believe so. As ordained by the Word of God, fathers are to be the priests in their family. And as you remember the title of the message, Never Let Go of the Wheel, I think this sort of brings it into light even a little bit more of what being the priests of our family really means. And we're going to watch a clip of the movie Courageous. And then we're going to finish the sermon here in a little bit. Being the priest of our family means never letting go of the wheel. God has given us this family to lead. And it's like, you know, God doesn't steer the car for us. He gives us direction, and he enables us to make the choice. Okay? So in this clip that we saw, this father would not let go of the wheel. He knew his responsibility was for his son. And he would not let go of the wheel, no matter how hard it was, no matter how strong the enemy was that was trying to take his son away from him and his family away from him. He wouldn't let go of the wheel. And if you watch the rest of that movie, you know that it's because of the godly character in this man. But he refused to let go of the wheel. I think sadly, in our society, in our day, many fathers are letting go of the wheel. They're allowing their families to be driven by the enemy in so many different ways, whether it's through media, whether it's through other influences, whether it's just by being so busy and consumed with self and our own jobs or our own life, whatever it is, and we allow our family to be taken off the right track. We allow our families to be solely led by the school system, which isn't bad, but we need a spiritual backing. Amen? We allow our families to solely be driven by their peers, by other influences besides us. And it's not that all influences are bad. It's not that all friends are bad. But we need to give them the spiritual backing. Amen. So we have to have the resolve of that man in the car that he would not let go of the wheel no matter what, no matter how much culture is against godly teaching, no matter what our culture teaches us, no matter how strong the enemy is against us, we have to have this resolve to never let go of the wheel. I'm going to tell you this. In this church, we're going to have fathers who don't let go of the wheel. Amen. Because I believe that's the hope in this culture, in this nation. I believe it's the hope. And why do I believe it's the hope? Because it was the hope of the children of Israel. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Malachi. We're going to go through the book of Malachi during this series. Malachi is the last Old Testament prophet, the last book in the Old Testament. And the only hope for the people of Israel in Malachi's day was for fathers to not let go of the wheel. And we're going to read about it in Malachi 4, 5, and 6. It says, behold, I'm going to send you Elijah, the prophet, before their coming, before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. He will restore the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, so that I will not come and smite the land with a curse. Why would Malachi say that? I mean, right there, the hope of Israel was that a messenger would come and he would turn the hearts of fathers to their children. Otherwise, a curse was coming. Their hope was in this turning of the hearts of fathers. Now, you have to know just a little bit about Malachi. And I hope you guys stay with me here. We're going somewhere. But the culture in which Malachi was written is the culture in which the exiles, God had sent his people into exile for their disobedience, into a foreign land. And so now, the exiles had come back to Jerusalem, and they had rebuilt the temple, which was the center of worship for God's people in Jerusalem. They had rebuilt the temple, which had been destroyed by their enemies. They had come back to Jerusalem, they had rebuilt the temple, and even Nehemiah and Ezra had set up the wall around Jerusalem, or else they were in process of it. And so now we have the book of Malachi, the prophet Malachi, coming into the picture. When the structure was built, on the outside, the temple was looking great. On the outside, everything was looking good. But on the inside, there was a problem. I think that's what dads are really good at. I think we're really good at making things look good on the outside. And even maintenance is this passion that we have. You know, we want to fix things. We want to make things look all nice. I remember when I first got I had a Mustang when I was in school. A 95 Mustang. Man, I was real proud of that thing. I would wax it almost every week or every other day when I first got it. Man, I was really proud of that. I wanted to make it look really good on the outside. But on the inside, man, I'd trash that thing up. My dad would get so mad at me. See, we're really good at making things look good on the outside, but when it comes to the inside, we don't really see things that need to be done a lot of times. And that's what was happening in Malachi's day. The priests who were in charge of offering sacrifices and who were in charge of making sure that the people were right with God, man, the priests were defiled. If you go back to Malachi chapter 1, you're going to read about the priests who offered sacrifices to God that were blemished, that were like their leftovers. When God had commanded that a perfect sacrifice be offered, that a sacrifice unblemished, unbroken, a sacrifice that wasn't lame, a sacrifice that was from the first of their flock. He commanded, he'd given all these regulations for sacrifices, and the priests, they were just keeping those sacrifices the priests brought for themselves. And so God's like, would you bring these gifts to your governor? Try bringing what you're bringing to me, someone else who's in charge of you, and see how they like it. Much more me, because remember, he's a holy God, and he expects us to do what his word says. So he was holding these priests accountable, and he promised, as we read right here, that they would have that there would be a curse that comes on the land because of what these priests had done. And he even goes a little bit further, and he says, I'm going to smear the waste of these sacrifices, the burnt up parts. They will be smeared on your faces and on the faces of your offspring, just so everybody can know who you really are and what you're really offering to me. You're offering me the leftovers. You're offering me the waste of your sacrifices. So Malachi, God gives Malachi a word. God gives Malachi a word in the midst of this darkness. And nothing else is known about the prophet Malachi. Nowhere else in Scripture is Malachi mentioned except in the book of Malachi. And God gives him a word of hope for his people. And the hope involves, he will restore. Behold, I'm going to send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. Who was Elijah the prophet? It was John the Baptist. If you read it in Luke chapter 1, an angel appears to Zechariah, John the Baptist's son, and he further confirms that John the Baptist is the prophet Elijah, someone in the form of the prophet Elijah, and the spirit and the power of Elijah, it says. And so he says, I'm going to send you a messenger, a prophet before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. What was John the Baptist's position? His position, whenever he came on the scene, he was the forerunner of Christ, right? He came before Christ. He said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. And so he was ushering in a repentance for the people, a chance for them to turn from their sins. And not to just turn away from something, but why? Because the kingdom of heaven is coming. In fact, it's here right now. The kingdom of heaven is here. And who brought the kingdom of heaven? Jesus brought the kingdom of heaven. And so John's purpose was to preach a message of repentance. People would turn from their sins and embrace the king of the kingdom that was coming. And his name was Jesus. And this king that is coming, he brings a kingdom in which he wants to rule in our lives. Not just as a guest, not just as someone that just comes along and you sort of treat however you want to, but this king is coming, that he wants to rule in your life in all power and all authority. That's the king and the kingdom of God, and his name is Jesus. And John said, a greater one is coming after me, and I'm not worthy even to untie his sandals. I baptize you with water as a sign of repentance, but this Jesus, he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. This Jesus that's coming, he's going to cleanse you from your sins. And he's going to give you the power to live victoriously through the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit. And so this messenger that Malachi was talking about, it was all about Jesus, because John was all about Jesus, right? This messenger was steering the people of God to Jesus. Away from themselves, away from their own selfish desires, away from just giving leftovers to God. This messenger was steering them to Jesus. And I think as priests of our families, dads, as priests of our families, we have to steer our family towards intimacy with God through Jesus Christ. We have to steer our family towards intimacy with God through Jesus Christ. That's the only way that we're going to be able to effectively influence our family towards intimacy with God. If all we do is just instruct, if all we do is just teach harshly and God says this, that's good. But we have to have this relationship with God that's more than just a bunch of rules. But it's our desire. It's our love. The Word of God is our love. And the person that the Word of God gives us is our love. It's like having a... God's been showing me lately out of the Song of Songs, the Song of Solomon, what an intimate relationship with God really means. It's a love relationship where, yes, we hear him telling us, oh, you're altogether lovely. I love you. We hear how much of the love of God. It's a relationship that's reciprocal. I love you, but then we have to hear him saying back to us, I love you. I love you, God, but I hear you saying back to me, I love you. And it's this, I couldn't believe that God would say some of the things like he says to me. through the Song of Songs, like, come away with me. I'm faint with love. You're altogether lovely. Ah, you're beautiful. I mean, these are the thoughts that God thinks towards us. And we should think the same back to him. And some of my most memorable times with my family is just the times when I get my guitar out and we just worship. Jasmine and Josiah will go around the house just lifting their hands or dancing around or whatever. But it's times of worship. It's times of intimacy with God that we have because to have intimacy with God means to be a holy worshiper. As I was saying in the beginning, it's all about God's holiness. We wholly worship him. And we refuse to give him the leftovers like these priests were giving him. They weren't intimate with God. It was just a show. They were just going through the motions, and even their motions were wrong. We steer our family towards intimacy with God, of course, by being consistent in the instruction from the Word. We remind them daily, as Deuteronomy says. We teach them faithfully, as Ephesians 6 says. And we live it consistently before them. We live it consistently before them. We're a family priest who does as Romans 12:1 says. We offer ourselves to God a holy and acceptable sacrifice. We offer ourselves, all that we are, our best to God. I read a statistic just yesterday, I think, that says the average father spends 39 seconds with their children a day. Can you believe that? 39 seconds. And so I was going about I was trying to get some things straightened up in the house, and then I was also doing some studying for the message this morning, and Josiah was just wanting my attention, and I remembered that. I was like, man, I got to spend some time with him. I need to spend some time with my family. Because this is who I have. This is who God has given me. You understand? This is who God has given us to lead before anybody else. God reminded me early in my ministry that my family is my first church. And to them, I'm responsible and accountable. And I will be my family's priest. When it's hard, whenever everything in me feels like that I'm just so weak, I will be strong. Whenever everything in me doesn't really feel like worshiping, doesn't really feel like reading, when I'd rather just get on with my day, I will teach my children. Because first of all, my intimacy with God means that much. And secondly, my children need it. Amen? Amen. So where do we find ourselves? Where do we find ourselves this morning? Either we're holding on to the wheel, holding fast, and not letting the enemy steal, kill, and destroy our families, or else we've been letting go. Maybe it's not an altogether letting go, but it's just sort of like letting the car sort of drift off a little bit. Well, my challenge to you today, husbands, dads, is to gain control again. Grab a hold of the wheel and never let go. Grab a hold of the wheel. I don't know if the pianist could come, or I guess these guys are up in the sound. The pianist, could you come and play something softly on the piano? She's in the nursery. Okay. But I want to have a response time here today. I really do. So let's all stand up. A sermon isn't much of a sermon if you don't invite your people to do something. And so here's your invitation. Your invitation, first of all, is to accept your God-given role as a family priest, dads. Your invitation, ladies, is to begin holding your men, the men in your life, accountable to their role as a family priest and being supportive of them in this role. Husbands, fathers, this is your time. If you just want to come forward and pray, man, God, help me to regain control of my family. God, help me not to grow fearful. God, help me not to let go whenever everything is against me, but help me to hold on strong to my family in these times. God, I want to draw close to you, intimately with you, because I know my family is not going to rise above my leadership. If I want my family to have a close relationship with God, man, I got to be right by his side. And there's nothing more important, right? There's nothing more important. All the money, all the things that we like in this world, besides Jesus, one day, it's all gonna burn. It's not gonna matter. Our family and our accepting of this role is what matters. So as I pray, anybody who wants to pray, just you can join me up front here, pray at your seat, however you'd like to. I'd like to pray with you if you want me to. Jesus, we thank you.